I praise and thank God for this beautiful morning that God has given in each one of our lives. For today's morning meditation, let's open our Bibles to Acts chapter 20, verse 24. I consider my love worth nothing to me, if only I may finish the race and complete the task the Lord Jesus has given me, the task of testifying to the gospel of God's grace. Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we praise and thank you, Lord, for this morning, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for the word. Help us to understand, Lord, while we are living in this world, what is our primary task in this world, Lord. Holy Spirit, help us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So the Bible verse that we read, my friends, it talks about Paul has been traveling all around to Gentile cities preaching the gospel message. He now feels led to go back to Jerusalem. He was run out of there by the Jews and so would not know what would happen when he goes there. He does know that everywhere he went, he had to face persecutions and prison a lot. He now says that to himself, his life is worthless. His whole goal in life is to do what Jesus wants him to do, to preach the gospel message. Right? When we read the Bible verse, it starts saying, "But none of these things move me." From the preceding verses, Paul was scheduled to travel to Jerusalem, realizing that difficult times were ahead. He made his mind not to be moved by them, right? He was sorrowful but not moved. Hallelujah. I wonder why this verse started with things and not life itself. It appears things are the least that affect us as believers today. Things may be regarding items or situations. They could either be positive or negative. Positive things like status in the society, wealth, even the blessings of God. While negative things could be persecution, trials, temptations, among others. However, regardless of the type of things, like Paul, we should not allow it move us. What then should move us as believers? We can read that in Philippians chapter 3, 7 and 8. The excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my God. Not just Christ Jesus, but my Lord. If he is not my Lord, then I cannot be deeply rooted in him, and definitely things would move me. Counting all things but lose and dung for the excellency of the knowledge of the Jesus Christ. This knowledge does not refer to the type of knowledge obtained from schools, my friends. The knowledge from first having a living relationship with Jesus, abiding in him and his Holy Spirit revealing him to us. In the book of Joshua, chapter 1:8, the knowledge of Christ translates into our action, which brings prosperity to our ways and success. What we see today among believers is the tendency to be moved by blessings, miracles, material prosperity, and not my raising Jesus. In Philippians 3:13 and 14, we see Paul speaking about forsaking things again. Perhaps this was the secret of his success in ministry, which is to desire and be moved by the risen Jesus and not things. If you read further, it says, "Neither count I my life dear unto myself." I wish to state that a life wholly entrusted unto Jesus and poured out as an offering for his glory is that which counts for him. All that a man has, he will give for his life. but all that a man has in life, too will he give, whose interest is in knowing Jesus and being a witness unto him. This is a resolution to submit totally to the will of God rather than deny him. The question is, do I count my life as dear to me? And when we read further, it says, so that I might finish my course with joy. Wow! What are those weights that easily beset us as believers? What are those things other than Jesus that move us or me? Am I willing to give up my life for Jesus rather than deny him? I perceive that our answers to these questions will determine if we will finish the Christian race with joy, or like the songwriter of the hymn, go I must, but empty-handed. Paul desired that he may be found faithful to God and that he may finish his race well. Oh, that I may finish my course with joy, and then all will be perfectly and eternally well. May I not be moved by things except the excellency of the knowledge of Jesus. May I also be willing to give up my life rather than to deny my Savior. There is so much depth in each of the phrases when we read the verse slowly. And further it says, and the ministry which I have received of the Lord Jesus. Every believer has a ministry, my friend. Not that we are all called to be pastors or head of the church or other, but we are entrusted with responsibilities in specific areas in the body of Christ. This ministry is not received from theological or biblical colleges, neither is it received based on any degree or excellence, intelligence that you have gained. It is received by the Jesus Christ. Many who are causing confusion in the church today either received their ministry from somewhere else or received it from Jesus but decided to wander away. The work must be done in the name of Jesus, and all glory must be ascribed to him. Oh, how little do we see this is our church today. Those who even try to practice this only end up paying lip service while their heart is far from the Lord Jesus Christ. Do we not see ministers choosing other sources rather than the fountain of life, full of grace and truth? Today, my friends, let God help us to retrace our steps in Jesus' name. And finally, he says, to testify the gospel of the grace of God. Amen. Is this the primary aim of most churches we see around us today? Thank God for the churches that are staying true to this. Why is the church today borrowing from traditions of the world? Marketing department spending enormous sum of money on programs which rather than drawing men to Christ only ending up entertaining people. Did Jesus not say, if I am lifted up, then I will bring men to myself? Are the messages from the pastors today not inclined to motivational speeching, psychology and self-belief rather than living the crucified life? The grace of God has enough to recommend itself. Oh, the testimony of the church today is hanging on miracles, blessings, and material prosperity that often don't have Jesus at the end state, my friends. What part of this gospel did Moses see that made him launch into the deep and ask God to show him his glory? What a part of it did Paul understand that made him cry out that I may know him? Like Paul, Father, gave me the grace not to be moved by prevailing things let me be willing to give myself up, then deny you, so that I may finish my course with joy. The ministry you have entrusted me with, let it continuously testify the gospel of your grace, is what our prayer to today should be, my friends. Where is your focus and aim today? Are you striving to be more like Jesus? Are you working hard at telling others about Jesus? Or are you working hard to get rich and have a great retirement plan set up? What is your goal today? Is the question we all have to ask ourselves. Jesus has a plan in our life. Each one of us, there is a plan when He created us. Let's ask for that plan and always proclaim His gospel around the world wherever we are. The living gospel of Jesus Christ, who died for each and every person in this world. It's yours and my responsibility to preach the gospel around the world. Whenever we get the opportunity, live like a living gospel in this world, my friends. Let the Lord help each one of us. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we praise and thank you, Lord, for this morning, Jesus. Lord, we pray today that Jesus will impress our heart to your heart, to your goals of our life, Lord. That we may know the plans Jesus has for each one of us. That we will aim to do the work Jesus has for us, Lord. That we will be more like Jesus every day, and that Jesus will draw many to Himself through us, Lord. Help us to spread your gospel around the world when we are living in this world, Lord Jesus, Father. Help each one of us to know our aim in this world. In Jesus' precious holy name we pray. Amen. May God bless you, my brothers and sisters. Jesus is coming very soon. Maranatha.